Sujata Raju Karu is there, who will be taking notes. So we were just discussing as to what we'll do in this. We have Professor B.N. Jain, who wants to have a 5-7 minute presentation, which he'll do in a moment. But I thought we'll start, all of you would have this sheet. We can go over the questions. But I thought before doing that, we can also spend a couple of minutes discussing the topic itself and taking it literally from there. Enabling and empowering educators is the topic. I think we can just ask the question, many of us are educators, what do we expect from technology to enable us, to empower us? Let's have a little set of questions from us itself. What do we want from the technology and so on? So we'll do that. Let Professor John Jain make his presentation, because I think he might have to leave. Then we can see. You wanted to reply, or do you have some other suggestion?
The presentation was
so you wanted to reply to these questions?
No, not that. I have one specific point. I want to have correlation between this NBA accreditation policy and this NMEICT, so that we can make this e-content delivery as part of the quality education system, so that
I would like to focus on the topic only. So content, there is a content team. Assessment, there is an assessment team. And content creation, assessment, and there is a use. So I would like in this to be focused on just the topic given to us.
Related topics, actually.
But let's first see, if after this topic is done, if we have time, then we can discuss other things. But let's try to give these organizers a few bullet points from our side as to what we will do.
All day we have discussed more about online learning or online teaching. And to my mind, there is only one part of how ICT can be used in the entire education sector. So I want to share with you my own experience at BITS Columbia as to how we use. And of course, I cannot share, because of time constraints, all that we do in BITS Columbia, but I do want to give a glimpse of what we do. So let me not go through this long story, right? But let me focus immediately on the time when internet suddenly became the talk of the town, which is when the web happened. And to my mind, I think we haven't quite been able to use the web in all its potential. And let me talk not about the various things, but about three things.
The first.
And I'm not talking about IITs. Let's not focus our attention on the IITs. Let's talk about the 42,000 institutions in this country and the 28 million people who are in the higher education. Had these 42,000 colleges begun to use the web effectively for the purpose of enrolling students? My gut feeling is there are very, very few institutions in this country that use the web for this purpose. How many of our institutions are using the web for the purpose of recruiting faculty? Are we still seeking applications in paper form? My gut feeling is 99% of our educational institutions do that. Very few institutions. And I can tell you, IIT Delhi started to do that in 2006, not before that. The web came about in the year 1995, or just before that. Access to library resources, particularly e-resources. How many of our universities are geared to using journals in electronic form? Very few. And I think the time has come for us to not simply promote online education as the mantra for ICT in higher education. We need to emphasize the fact that journals are available in electronic form, and these are available to all the colleges and universities in the country. The third, how many of our universities actually have put in place systems so that they can actually track the entire student life cycle from the day they get admitted to the day they graduate? Very few universities do that. I think these are three out of very many that I think we need to focus on. ICT in higher education is not about MOOCs. Of course, I have my own views about MOOCs, and I think MOOCs are going to be very important for this country, and I'll talk about that very quickly. I'm going to talk about three applications for which I believe BITS Pilani is known to be a pioneer. The first is ERP, the Enterprise Resource Planning tool that we implemented in BITS Pilani. The second is the BITSAT examination then that we introduced in the year 2005. The third is the telepresence network of conference rooms and classrooms. And of course, we are working on other things. We are also now putting together, we are building a data analytics center, which will take inputs from the ERP system and spit out processed information so that the administrations or the leaders can actually track as to what is happening in the university. This is what we call the dashboard. This ERP system will help us populate the dashboard, and one of the areas for the dashboard is quality assessment of teaching research. And of course, if you are able to assess the quality of teaching that you deliver, hopefully we'll be able to assure quality of teaching that you deliver. Appraisal of faculty performance, etc., etc. This is a sample dashboard. I have not shared with you everything that we do in Spilani as far as the dashboard is concerned. There are 21 metrics, and here I think I've listed only 16 or 17 of those. Right? I, as a vice chancellor or a director of a campus, wants to know if we were supposed to invest 150 crore rupees in building construction, how much have we done? We need to know if we had intended to enroll, let's say, 2,500 students this year, how many have we enrolled? How many of our students have been placed, and so on and so forth. The second part is quality assessment, quality of teaching, quality of research. And I think ICT has a very major role to play. The second application is the online test for admissions that BITS Pilani put together in 2005. Right? It's been there. It's the first in India. It is used for the purpose of admissions to the undergraduate program. Right? I dare say CAT came about just 2-3 years back. IITs have started to experiment with online education, online testing, just 2 years back or 1 year back, and so on and so forth. Right? Last summer, 139,000 students took the test. And I'll tell you how. They took the test over 50 different sessions, spread over 15 days or so. These are proctored with biometrics. Every student has to provide his fingerprint. That is how we use ICT. I must share with you that there was one student who did not take the test himself, but reported for admission on the day of admissions. Did we find him? Yes, of course, we detected the fact that he's not the same person as the one who took the test. The entire processing is, my own sense is that I think in the last 9 years that we've conducted, we have saved at least 5,000 reams of paper. And I don't know what that translates into in terms of number of keys. So what's the big deal about this online testing? The big deal of the online testing is that, first of all, you've got to take a decision. No two students write the same test. They write comparative tests. And if you do that, then you can hold the test any time of the day, any day in the week, any day in the month, and you can hold it anywhere else in the world. The way the CAT is configured, the way JEE is configured, you cannot do that. Even if you went online, you've got to take this very central decision that no two students necessarily have to take the same test. And of course, there are implications of this. If a student misses the test for some reason, misses the bus, or falls ill, he can come back and take the test the next day. We should use ICT to be able to make our systems more flexible, and so on and so forth. Environmentally friendly, efficient, transparent, blah, blah, blah. The third application. Cisco has this beautiful technology called telepresence. Right? What this shows is a picture of a conference room in Pilani. There's actually a picture from the inauguration of this facility. Right? It seats 18 people in the conference room, and we have such conference rooms in Goa campus as well as in Hyderabad campus. Right? There are three big screens out there, and these three big screens open up into the conference room in Goa, or the conference room in Hyderabad, or in the facility. And of course, there are little screens that you see out there, but actually many, many more locations that are connected globally. What do we use it for? I use it for to meet with the entire leadership, all 36 heads of the department across the campus of India. I use it to meet all new faculty members whenever I need to meet them. face-to-face. Experience is not what you see in Skype. The experience is not what you saw in the morning when Professor Raghavan was talking. The experience is almost, it's eye to eye. They call it immersive. When visiting committees visit our campuses, they can talk to various departments or faculty members across the campuses. Research collaboration becomes possible. I don't want to spend your time on a very fantastic example. In a matter of 16 hours, faculty members from across the three campuses got together, used this facility, and put together a 26 crore rupee project proposal. That's how you use these facilities for. PhD YOOC, across all campuses. Faculty hiring happens across all campuses. A potential faculty member can show up anywhere in Goa, Delhi, or Hyderabad to be interviewed. So on and so forth. This is the telepresence network. This is the telepresence based classrooms. We have such classrooms across the three campuses, and we're putting more such classrooms. How do we use it for? A faculty member in Goa, for instance, gives a course across the three campuses. Of course, we're not talking about 200 plus 200 plus 200, we're talking about 15 plus 15 plus 17. Right? I still believe that 600 students cannot be taught by one faculty member at the same time, but certainly 50, 60, 100 students can be taught by a faculty member across three different locations. What does that mean? It means that if I have to give 15 courses in any given semester in each of the three campuses, I do not have to deploy 45 faculty members. I can do that with only 15 faculty members. What does that mean? 30 of my faculty members have more time to do research. Going forward, because I'll take 2 more minutes to share my thoughts on MOOC, right? Of course, I have some of my friends who are part of the FICCI the subcommittee on MOOCs, right? So technology will continue to evolve, open new applications. I think this is what Anoop also said this morning. So whether it is MOOCs or Sparks, I think one will still have to figure it out. So these are other things. Let me talk about MOOCs. MOOCs are phenomenal. Our understanding of MOOCs use SPOCs for our purpose, for our own students. And I'll tell you why we want to use this for our own students. Because it helps address a business problem for them. So SPOCs will help improve quality and scale of courses on campus and off campus. We have 11,500 students studying on a 4-campus in Dubai. We have 20,000 people from the industry who are registered with us for a program, a degree program. So we have 31,500 students who we teach. It will help me improve quality as well as scale. In other words, I can look to go to 60,000 students in the next 10 years or so. More generally in India, SPOCs will help improve quality of education offered. Fee-paying, closed group of users, enrolled for a degree and diploma programs. This tells me that if I have to teach a course on thermodynamics, I need to deploy 8, 10 to 12 faculty members. And you can well imagine that the quality of faculty members we deploy is not uniformly good. In some cases it is fantastic, in other cases it is terrible. I hope you agree with me there. What MOOCs will help me do is to raise the average from 5.5 to at least 7.5, if not 8.5. We will of course merge this concept of MOOCs with flipped classes, which is to say that instead of having one tutorial per week, we'll have 2 tutorials per week. More importantly, for India, not about this, but for India, we have 28 million students in the higher education sector. And this is going to be 15 million very shortly. By shortly, I mean another 15 odd years, we'll have 15 million students in higher education sector. What that means is that you've got to increase the capacity to teach these 15 million. To teach the additional 22 million, which is to say you will need another 15 to 20 million seats in classrooms. And my own assessment is it's going to take you 4 trillion rupees to create those seats. Similarly, it will require an additional 1 million faculty members. And imagine trying to hire 1 million faculty members in the next 10 years. Given a situation where 20 to 50% of all faculty positions in all universities in India are now vacant. Given the fact that there are certain universities where the youngest faculty member is only 50 years old, which is to say that that university will not have a faculty member in about 10 or 15 years. So how do we scale up this from 28 million to 50 million? I think you know what the answer is. And of course, we haven't talked about the 200 to 500 million young men and women who need to be skilled. To my mind, while MOOCs are still evolving, we as a nation cannot wait, cannot afford to wait. Let me stop here, right? Of course, there are many other things that we need to look at, right? But whenever we do ICT, we've got to ask the question, does it solve a problem that I cannot otherwise solve? First thing. Second, flexibility, transparency, fairness, timeliness, economy. I think we need to address those questions before we start deploying our policies. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Jain. I'll just try to put a framework. So Dr. Jain looked at essentially from the BITS Pilani perspective how three areas you use technology very effectively. Right?
Let me just add one more thing. These are just three which are fairly mature.
Three he mentioned, of course they're using it in a lot of other areas. So that's from an institution perspective. He's of course the Vice Chancellor, so he has to look at that. I think what if we agree we can focus this discussion literally on taking this thing, enabling and empowering educators, right? What I'll do is I'll list down two, three tasks that educators do. Then we'll ask the question, how can these IT-based technologies that have been talked about, MOOCs, et cetera, help educators in any of the things we do? That's the first question. The second, since they have addressed it, also, how can these technologies be used for the teachers' training program per se? That's also a question, right? So let me just see whether I've got it right. So I was thinking I'll first put down what are the main things an educator do. We will also not talk about the research as a side of our lives, right? Because I'm taking it very literally, because all this is focused on education. Research is a whole different ballgame. So I put down, and you please correct me if we need to. So job of an educator. So since I need to use this, I request you to please, once we agree, to take some notes. So clearly the job of an educator, first of all, is teaching a subject in a semester. I'm assuming pretty much all are in semester world. One of our main tasks is one course, two course, three courses, but each course is independent of each other by and large, right? I'll put down some sublimits under it. Clearly that's one of our main tasks. There is another main task that I think all of us do is mentor, guide students for projects, B.Tech thesis, maybe M.Tech. I'm leaving out PhD here because that goes into the research world. There is another thing which some of us do, perhaps not all of us would be doing, would be design new courses. So this is something that autonomous universities, faculty every now and then do, but not everyone does. Yeah, curriculum, I was thinking, it's a collection of educators who do curriculum development, but yeah, we can put that. Curriculum development is not the task of an educator or educators individually. That's a task typically done by a whole set of educators, a senate or whatever. Is that seems like a good framework to have a discussion in? And then question that I want to ask is, how can teachers get better? Now, better in terms of less time, better quality, you define better whichever way, through use of IT, which includes in a very broad way. MOOC, NPTEL, various other things. Right? So all that we've discussed today. So that's what I'm hoping that we can do in this. So that's I'm setting the framework. Does that look, anyone wants to add to the framework?
Where would you put assessments?
So I will not yet put down the sub-bullets. Okay. So sub-bullets I have, for example, lectures, assignments, grading, upgrading of curriculum, motivating students. So I'll put things down under, when we have to teach a course, what all do we need to do? When we need to guide a student, what all do we do? And then each of these sub-bullets, you can argue how we can do it.
In the question segment, question 3 and question 7, which talks about how do we motivate teachers to actually use it?
Good point. So how can we, then the question, and we can also ask how to motivate teachers. Why don't I include motivate and improve, because there's all this thing about teachers training, faculty developing. Yeah, good point.
So I don't actually have the question set in my list, and it maybe it's in those two questions, but there is something about not just motivating, but how do we support teachers or academics in coming to technology before they can get better at it. Now you might say that's motivating, okay. But there's the ongoing support as well.
Okay, so before teachers can even get better at using these tools and technologies for their task, how do we sort of give them enough idea, hands-on experience, etc., so they know what they can do with it? Is that the question?
I think it's a question between question 2 and question 1. So you might motivate them, and then you might show them by example and help them understand. Okay. And then your question 3 is your question 1.
We're talking about adoption, technology adoption issues. If I say this tool seems to be good for me, now there's a whole issue of me adopting technology.
Yes.
So somebody needs to help me, the technology has to be easy, etc., etc. Getting started, technology adoption.
How many of you have had any exposure to using ICT in class?
Not bad.
Oh, good.
How many of you have had students who have used ICT? And who come back and tell you about it.
ICT for learning, you mean?
Yes, ICT for learning. And what is the overwhelming feedback from the students?
It's amazing. Yeah. I mean, initially it's sort of intimidation and then complete transformation.
No, not from you, but even outside.
I'm talking about students. So initially it's like they have not ever entered.
I know, but this is when you're talking about when you use ICT in the student's reaction. So how many of you have students who use ICT outside of your class? I mean, courses taught by someone else. So in some sense, that's the flipped class. They're already practicing it. We have to tune ourselves to
how the role of the teacher will change in an IT-enabled
exactly,
world.
Yeah. So that's why I wanted this paper. Role of teacher in ICT.
So how does role, a very important, of teacher change or evolve with use of these tools? I think that's a very important question. Is that if you do accept that you want to use it, then do we continue doing the same thing with a little bit of this, or do we change? Okay, broadly, then we'll put down these things and then we'll start questioning. Yeah.
Challenges. What challenges are in fact?
Challenges for?
When we are using ICT for imparting training, what major challenges are?
Quite right.
Motivation is one part of the teachers, but challenges in terms of technology, in terms of
challenges in use of ICT.
Yes.
I'll put it in, so it could be part of it.
I think that you can put question 2 broadly as challenges.
How to motivate, because that's also part of the challenge.
Motivate is one part. Another one is connectivity part, because India is so big country. The infrastructure.
Let's talk about assuming that all that is there, because otherwise we get lost in some of these things. That has to be, without that one we won't be able to.
It's important. there is no doubt about it. We need water, we need internet, all that is very important, no doubt about it. And I'm saying the question we should perhaps, because we have only 1.5 hours to hopefully come to some agreement. If you agree, let me just put down now some sub-bullets here. That will give us the framework. So what I had put down, and we can just put, of course, for teaching, we give lectures. We do assignments and small assignments. We do grading, very challenging portion. We do projects, perhaps in classes. We motivate students.
Take attendance.
And then of course there is course management.
Course feedback.
Course feedback, in fact, these are places where technology is very, is almost standard use. And also sometimes we just update, improve curriculum. Right, we can list some more. And let me just put a sort of cross-cutting concern.
Class should be interactive.
The cross-cutting concern which teachers need to have is to have subject matter expertise. I mean, you don't do it as when you're teaching, but if you don't have subject matter expertise, there's a challenge. The reason I really want to put it, because much of the teacher's training program seem to be addressing this issue rather than any other issue. That's my take on it. Now, please, Ryu, is that generally agreeable? Then we can start talking about how can technology move this, that, help here, take some this thing, put down some notes. How can it help? How have you seen your experience and how you think it may help? And then we'll resolve that.
I'm from IIT Kharagpur. Actually, I'm Raja Datta. There are some feedback. In fact, we are with Professor Fatas that trained to 10,000 teachers, and there are some feedbacks I can share with you, which will help in the discussion. Actually, the feedback which we are talking about, like we had recently finished one workshop on signals and systems, and I think it will help in the discussion.
Yeah, please tell.
The feedback. Should I say it or?
Yeah, I think it's. There is. We are using all this.
Right.
I'll take some notes.
Right. We had given some 29 questions to our participants.
Can you please just explain feedback on what?
The feedback was on a workshop conducted by IIT Kharagpur last semester on signals and systems. There's a course, signals and systems. In 10,000 teachers,
But if you don't mind, signals and systems is a topic.
It's. I'm giving you. This is just an instance of a workshop.
So feedback on using some method.
Using a method,
Method. Just a method.
Basically, let me just give you some examples. Like the highest qualification of the teachers in India. M.Tech is around 71.68%. So this is the highest qualification we have got. So it just to take an instance, and then I think it can be generalized a little bit. Age group, of course, is very important. Of the teachers, they participate in this type of ICT programs. 25 to 30 years is 44 or 45%. Yeah, age group is very important. Less than 25 years also, they are mostly B.Tech teachers. They are 10.5%. 30 to 35 is around 25.38%.
So this feedback was collected through analytics? Did they use ICT to collect all this feedback?
Yeah, after this workshop, we had collected this feedback.
I would like to issue, if you wish to. The other one, if it goes back.
Okay. We can discuss.
If you agree to this framework, then you make it very nice if that feedback you tried to be lecturing, you found in motivation, you found in something you found. Otherwise, it goes another talk and then we have to go back.
Right.
So yes, please. Now you please start commenting.
So a lot of courses have some practical component, for example, a lab.
So projects for assignments, what gets called is assignments, projects or labs.
Very nice, quite right. Electrical, mechanical, absolutely.
Yes, I was going to say the same actually about, I think some of that list is subject specific, because if you talk to the social scientists, they will talk about seminars,
discussions,
about tutorials,
discussions,
so
role play.
I think there's something
absolutely
about that.
Discussions, role play,
But it's part of the pedagogy.
So you as instructor will have to facilitate role play, discussion and so on, and we need to do that.
I was going to say, one thing that's really struck me about today actually is how brave and bold you are being as a nation with your endeavour. I'm serious about that. I know that sounds crass, but actually I don't think I've seen anything as brave and bold as this. And yet, disappointingly, I see lectures at the top. Because you could talk about education in the broadest sense, and then you think, is our lectures involved in ICT? Because otherwise, you just technologize the lecture.
So you're saying if we use this, can we just sort of get out of the flip class, out of the lecture, this thing?
I think you're doing such a brave thing, and to miss thinking about what good education looks like is a real missed opportunity. Because otherwise, you're just using your existing model of education and using technology rather than.
Point well taken. What we should do is, because so we've had these discussions, how do you really do education totally differently? But the fact of the matter is, a lot of education will continue to get done the way it is getting done. We can improve it through the use of technology. At some point, maybe it will get reversed into a very different.
For us in India, it's a paradigm shift to be even talking about bringing technology in the classroom.
It just seems so brave and bold. You're
nearly
there.
Or reckless. It could be one.
Yes,
or reckless.
So I have a pointer. I'm a very avid technology, I would say, savvy faculty. But yet, I would respect some of the conventional practices we follow. And we have to look at that exact interplay that is required for a subject or a classroom, you know, in terms of the numbers.
That, and I would put it in another way also, the way the system is set up. It's not going to go away anytime soon. We will be asked to teach a course. We will give lectures 3 times a week. What we can do is make it more interesting, make it more lively, make it more learning experience. All that we can do, active learning, all that we can put in there. So, but that's an excellent point. How do you just do it in a very different way? So learning happens, and maybe teaching is not easy. But let's discuss on this, and if we start now the thing, so we can start taking
down. Content, because we, I know research is a different ballgame altogether, but I seriously feel that if a teacher has to survive today, we have to be good researchers. We have to, because of the ephemeral nature of content and how we have to ensure that every day we give them exactly what is meant at that particular time. So that research bent has to.
I couldn't agree with you more, but if you go into that round, but I mean that's why I specifically put this thing, and I don't think you can be a subject matter expert one time and then stay subject matter expert for the next 10 years, which is the point of view. So shall we put down some ideas now?
Blending the teaching with industry, like summer internship, semester training, all those stuff.
Right.
I would also say exchange programs for teachers, faculty. I would even be bold enough to say that even administrators need exposure
That's a teacher improvement. Are you talking about the students or she's talking about faculty? Talking about students?
Yes.
How do the students get exposed to
industry?
Sir, maybe it can be a function school concept. Otherwise, in a 4 years course, time will not be sufficient for the students.
Over 8 weeks training, full semester training, there are
similar
to summer school. So sending faculty to the industry and industry people coming to the educational institutes to share their experiences. So blending this industrial experience.
Are you talking of how to deliver better quality faculty?
How
do we use IT in all that we do, or how do we improve?
So I'm trying to narrow down so we can say something. The question to this, The teachers are what they are as of now, though there is this other question. First question we should ask, how can we as teachers use any of the things that we've heard, read about, thought about into any of these or this task? The second is, of course, how do you improve the teachers? The question that I think in India we are very.
Would you like to comment? One more point. How do teachers help other teachers to perform better? So there's no community aspect.
So you're saying besides teaching a subject, besides mentoring, we also form a community?
Instead of a question, can that be like a solution?
Community of teachers?
Yeah. Instead of using that like a question, we could use that as a solution.
That's true.
This community
this
of teachers.
One we could
use like a solution.
Okay, the way I put it is, this is another job we educators do, that we are a community and we can use technology to actually help in our community work. Facebook, actually community is really, social networks is really very, very possible here.
A teacher helps another teacher on ICT and that could be a solution towards the question.
Co-teaching.
Yeah, co-teaching.
Okay, so how do we put that?
That could be like a solution to these questions.
I just want to add one thing, very very major thing here is acquiring the degree does not mean he becomes a teacher. It's a very big issue now. Now if you feel that his M.Tech or PhD becomes a teacher, is a very big issue, right? So what we have to do, just become the teacher. Using ICT or technology in different fashion is a different thing. As a teacher in the classroom is a totally different idea. So we have to focus on the fifth point here, which is already there. That is the need to integrate faculty development program for that. It should be a solution type sort of thing rather than the question. So what we have to focus on rather than the questioning, how can the teacher get use of IT? First, we have to prepare them as a teacher. Because as this one to add, I already discussed with you, we are the four NITTTRs working for last 45 years for teachers training program in pedagogy and other things.
Right.
Now, what we can propose here is, if anybody is from M.Tech or PhD or somewhere, first, they have to go for, Ministry is also thinking in that direction, 3 to 4 months of integrated course using ICT with the approach of pedagogy.
So now, use of this
how can, that's why, first point is, how we can say this become a teacher? No. Teacher is having a different characteristics. Some people is a born teacher, maybe born teacher, but some require something. Means let's add to the third part, the content delivery. I'm not going for that. But if we are going for ICT enabled, because our topic is enabling, empowering educator for ICT. We should be very, very careful in that. Before answering all this, first part, teaching subject, all this, all required pedagogical approach using ICT technology.
There's no before after. Yeah. This is a very valid question.
Yeah.
How can we use ICT for faculty development? You are in particular talking about pedagogic training.
Basic question is different. Question is that AICT gave some qualification for teachers. Okay. Now if you are M.Tech, then you become a teacher. He is saying that a person should have gone a training program where the teaching learning process and pedagogy should be
Are
you talking about AICT qualification? No. That's really a very different thing. You're talking about faculty development.
Understood.
To relate it to this, I'm posing the same question. I think that's what you're saying. How can we use these technology tools for the faculty, what development I'm calling it?
When we are proposing something to the planning commission or the Metro Media, it should be a policy matter that a person who is going to be a technical teacher must possess following qualifications.
So if you want to get into that, many of us may disagree with that. If you want to discuss policy, that's going to be very big. I disagree actually.
Not only possessing the qualification.
I don't know because I never have gotten the certificate of being a teacher.
That is why this situation is.
So if we discuss the policy, then we'll get into tick.
You know, just as we say that we should have the facility, we should use ICT for students to be assessed anytime, anywhere, or ramp up their skills. You know, ICT can very well work, do the same work for faculty as well.
Ma'am, that's true. Ma'am, it's very intuitive, it's very hands-on, we learn on our own. But what I think I sort of agree is that if you are here today just to contribute a thought And that is exactly what I personally, I would feel that yes, if we can have a program which is a formal training program for school teachers, why not have a higher education
I think, ma'am, the question being raised is there are two sets of teachers
and
we're talking about.
And that will enable and empower
new teachers and existing teachers. And if you talk about new teachers, yes, there could be a criteria to say, okay, whatever new teachers coming in can
have. Just think about the staff development colleges to have faculty and staff
colleges, yes.
It's not only new teachers.
But it should be very flexible.
Existing teachers,
I agree.
So formal training program for teachers, and since we are talking in this case, it's all about IT. How the question would be, how do we leverage technology for this?
How do we make it flexible
anytime, anywhere?
I mean, the whole idea is basically is making teachers, existing teachers, get on the IT platform for even if credits, let's say, or whatever.
But the idea is to get a certificate, or to get a certification, or to get a job, for future progress of career. We can't say qualification is not a teacher qualification.
It's basically MTech or something. That's not
it's
even
a subject
matter
expertise.
It's a subject matter expertise.
But how do you articulate
how to
present?
It's going for the learning-based learning outcomes, objective, writing objective, content analysis, which require a lot of efforts. Using ICT also.
Yeah, so that's, I mean, I think we should, it should just be leverage technology for formal
training program
for
teachers.
So another key component of flexibility and continuous exposure, which is continuously updated,
Absolutely. Yeah. Another point is that this will enable teachers to be immersed in the technology experience. Now we depend on others, that somebody will do something for us, somebody will even plug in the Wi-Fi connection for us, So that dependency, it's about becoming independent users and disseminators of technology.
What is the part of this is, if we go for 3 months, 4 months,
sir, you want to use. For any profession, there is training.
Faculty, staff development.
Even for going for industry, public sector or software industry. But for teaching, it's confident they are rarely entering without having even good communication skills or otherwise.
So, though just to keep in mind, perspective in mind, we have a BA MA program. I don't think it has helped school education.
That's
true.
No,
that one was
just to, because we as country are very, certificate, so just to put it in perspective, I think broadly we'll agree that BA MA has not improved our school education much at all.
But that one is education program, we are talking about the training program.
Training.
It's a totally different two issues.
So
one is education, another is training.
But training also, UGC has these training programs.
Nobody opts for it.
No, they opt for it, but they're made to feel that it's a drudgery, and I don't think anybody is happy. They're just waiting for the last day.
We are assuming here that the content of all that is good. We are going to get a company that the content is good.
I think we'll keep that as a point. There is no doubt that teachers, who are teachers, can benefit from teachers training. There's no doubt about that. From good teachers training.
We both are from ETS. There are four institutes in India. It is National Institute for Technical Teachers Training. One we are in Chandigarh, from where I am coming. And Professor Agarwal is from Bhopal, another institute we are in. Third we are having at Calcutta, fourth one at Chennai. So 1966-67 it has been started, and till 2 years back we were using the conventional method of training for the teachers, say short term training program, 7 days, 15 days, 10 days, even modular form. Last year we have started this ICT, and one part is this NPTEL part where videos are available on the website. Another one that is AVU software, in the morning we were discussing Amrita, this virtual software we are using. What our experience is, my experience is from Little Chandigarh, which I am saying, we are having very good
studio. Just to understand, so your model was that you would teach the teachers some modules about course design,
pedagogy or curriculum development, or entrepreneurship.
So you were teaching them as per a certain syllabus.
And teachers used to come to our place, So it was very costly affair, TA, a lot of money was needed. And in our region, say my region, I am controlling from Chandigarh, that is 9 states are there. Starting from Jammu and Kashmir to UP, it is in our area. Then Professor Agarwal is looking after 5 states, he is looking after. So in our case, in 9 states, starting from Jammu and Kashmir to UP, there are 4,500 institutes. Polytechnic, Engineering Colleges, Management Institute, Pharmacy. And our capacity was to train around 4,500 teachers per year. So 4,500 institutes we are having, we are able to train 4,500 teachers, one teacher per institute more or less. So we have started this ICT mode of imparting training.
If I may ask, once you just described that you sort of now teach the trainers,
yes.
Why can't we then just say that the prospective teachers are the students here and you are the instructor, and therefore we come back to the same problem of teaching teachers, teaching students in a more effective manner? Or is it a fundamentally different problem?
No, it's okay.
I thought of that because we also do that.
Yes, yes.
I thought it was still about teachers teaching a set of students. Doesn't have to be undergraduate. It happens to be us sitting here and maybe you standing here giving a lecture. Or is it a different problem?
A teacher having at the entry level professional teaching experience to have idea about how to go for teaching and mannerisms in that, etc. Second one is an inducted person getting a training, further training.
Continuing education.
Two different issues. So what we are lacking in India is a teacher is not being trained before teaching as a profession. Many people are joining as a stopgap arrangement. It's a fact. We have to accept it. So a situation has to come wherein everyone must be trained before taking up teaching as a profession. That's what our view is.
Lots of countries are pushing the notion of a dual professional, and that's,
yeah.
That's
something. UK has done a very nice, I've studied it, it's a little bit that I found out, it's nice one.
Lee Shulman's work on pedagogic experts, subject matter experts,
yeah,
you know that other people are now adding onto that technology knowledge as well. So if you're not familiar with it, have a look at the TPAC framework. You could go back to your government ministers and say, this is actually what we want our educators of the future to look like and have been engaged with. So some training or education around education, they have the subject matter expertise, and now you want to bring to them the wherewithal and understanding of how technology can help. When you get that right, wow.
Yeah. And that's...
TPAC.
That's a very nice model in
UCL
folks to explain to me a little bit. Very nice model they're doing of getting teachers through certain things. But in any case, I still think. Yeah, because I still think it comes down to somebody teaching there. And the reason I want to put it is because this is woefully lacking in the country for that kind of teaching. But that's just let me get into
yes. So what we are using from Chandigarh, what we are using Google Hangouts. In your case, you are using AVU, we are using Google Hangouts. So just seventh point which you are having in ours, no?
So use of social media. Google for?
How Google Hangouts.
Social media for content delivery, yes. Social media.
For interaction?
Social media. So we are using Google Hangouts, in fact.
For interaction between.
For interaction, we are
interaction
and
between.
And connectivity which you are having, we are having through Google Hangouts, through YouTube, in fact.
No, that's
Google Hangouts.
I'm trying to understand.
What is not Skype?
It's for delivery of the content.
Yes.
So is it for delivery of content?
It is for delivery. For delivery of content.
So for lectures itself, delivery of content,
yes.
You are using Google Hangout on that YouTube.
Yes, YouTube and server we are using of YouTube.
Sounds
whatever lecture has been delivered, it is live also, it is available and it is recorded on YouTube. So their server we are using. It's just like NPTEL, we are having one server, we are using YouTube server.
NPTEL has also put all the lectures on YouTube.
No, on YouTube also. It's same SLV people are putting. And just like NPTEL, we are having NCTL, Nitro Chandigarh Technology Enabled Learning, and around 1000 videos we are having on that one, which we have created during last 1.5 years, 2 years. No? Those whole videos are available on that one. Our training capacity, earlier we were having 4,500 teachers, now it has gone some 17,000, 18,000 per year. So training capacity of ours has gone up and cost of the training has gone down. Because teachers are not coming, they are at their own places, no TADA, nothing has to be given. So one, as Professor Arora was suggesting regarding industry part, what we are doing, suppose IC engine subject I have taken. We are giving training, one week we are keeping for pedagogy, 1 week we are keeping for content based. Suppose some new teachers they are.
So your module has pedagogy, content and so on. So this is a good point now, we led to this discussion. You are using, and maybe can we just record, so at least for teachers training modules, they are using Google Hangout and YouTube for content delivery. For lectures.
YouTube for scoring. For scoring. So the question is, Sanjay was raising that some training has to be for the teacher. So that pedagogy part which we are doing, that is basically even MTech someone has joined, but that pedagogy training which we are giving, I think more or less after certain experience, they are taking this advantage of this pedagogy training which we are giving. Then content-based part is coming.
Are you using any of these, for example, for assessment
of these teachers?
Just I complete. Then what we are doing for industry part, which is saying, suppose I am teaching IC engines, internal combustion engines I am teaching. So in 5 days training program, fundamental part I am taking, I'm from IT Delhi, and the fundamentals are very clear to me. Then some 5-6 lectures I'm giving to our R&D organization related to that subject. They are coming there and they are delivering. And 5-6 lectures we are giving to industry.
And this is in a classroom setting?
In a classroom, in a studio.
In a studio.
In a studio we are inviting. Say fundamental part of IC engines are covered.
No, and you take it.
Yeah.
And you tape it in
live session.
Live session. Interactive. It is interactive.
Okay. Good. That's
it, right. Is not just like NPTEL because it is one way. In our case, it is two way.
All right.
Okay. And 14, 15, even 11, 12 centers are connected simultaneously.
Good.
Right. So, the basic part of that subject I have covered. Then IIT Chennai say they are doing very good in internal combustion engine. I am inviting those professors there. So, what R&D they are doing in this subject they are covering. And how this R&D is being implemented by the industry. So 4-5 lectures in that particular course we are keeping from industry side. Say Maruti.
Okay, good. So I think this is something we should go down. What they do, very nice. It seems that they, for one module,
yes,
you are having distributed teachers.
Exactly, sir.
Somebody from IIT Delhi, from,
yes,
IIT Madras, from industry,
yes,
for delivering.
Yes,
here.
Yes. So we are combining that whole subject in such a way, making them interesting.
The point that you are doing, in fact, it goes beyond this. I think you should totally make a note of that, essentially use ICT for
coverage of
multiple
subject,
for collaborative teaching. Yes, collaborative teaching. Collaborative teaching. This is an excellent point where you can get teachers from across various places for special modules. And you've been trained very good.
So this is some industry also, interesting also, industry input is also coming.
And this is, I think, as the point you were saying, this is something that without the use of, as Professor Jain said before, this is something without the use of technology significantly harder. So I think the use of technology here makes a lot of sense, where the teachers are also distributed, students are also distributed. Excellent
use of. Which we are receiving, that's very good feedback. In fact, and online feedback we are getting from the teachers at end of the program.
Yeah.
Teachers are submitting their online feedback.
Teachers are distributed.
At
and students are
distributed.
Sir, just want to add one thing here is, as Dr. Punia is doing with the Google Hangout, we at NITDR is doing with the AVO. And we have roughly 75 to 80 remote centers there. And we are using blended technology, as the IIT Mumbai is and Kharagpur is using Moodle. Now the problem what we are thinking is, if we train the teacher for using technology, because we have given the task that under 6, that how can we go for the massive training, strategy for massive training. Now if we take up that challenge that how our teacher can train other teachers, because Professor Fatak conducted at a workshop at NITDR Bhopal, where we set up our own hub, AVU hub. Now the planning is that every university can have their own hub, and from there they can go for the different training courses. Right? Now the problem again is, if the teacher sits over there using ICT mode, the lecture in the face-to-face communication is a different type of approach is required, and using ICT is a different technology and a different approach is required. Say hands up or something. Is there anybody who can answer this? This question cannot be asked. My point is, if you're going for the Moodle sort of thing, the assignment preparation and the way you prepare yourself for ICT course is totally different. So we can have some strategy for that. I don't know how can we go for this type of training. This using, preparing our teacher to use ICT as a platform to deliver lectures. Means using online, means Hangout or AVU or any one method.
Yeah, this was question. Raised. So what some now,
no,
let's start, I think this clearly seems one place for, and also let me just close this a little bit. They have used Google Hangout and other things, but this clearly looks like a good use of technology to collaborate, both for teachers, both for this, and very difficult to do otherwise. They're using real time, you can go internet based, he's using internet based. I think this, if we can note down, is something we can suggest.
No, yes, please. I just want to add with him one thing, because
there is like we teachers are teaching, obviously the teachers they are distributed and they are listening to hands up or something what he was saying. The problem is that whenever you want to take some assignments in Moodle, there is a lot of disinterest among the teachers. That's what we had also felt. So how can as I think that's the yeah. very good point what he pointed out.
Assignments like, that you want to give to teachers
yes,
in the course.
Yes.
And how do you have them do the assignment?
Yes. Yes. That's because that's what we require. That's what is required. Because we need to give assignments so that they means whatever has been taught, whether they have understood it properly or.
The second thing is dissertation. If you are delivering lecture through ICT mode, then maybe at a time 20,000 teachers are there. Now, in contact mode, you are giving certificates for attending the courses. You just assignments are there. You check the assignments and then you certify them. Okay. But in ICT mode, you cannot say that this particular person has really being certified for being acquiring knowledge. So how to test that knowledge? That is
But why can't you assign a module to them which they should teach in the ICT mode to a group of children, to a group of students, and get the students' assessment, student
feedback. So they can do it, their respective colleges can
do that. Yeah, just as you are teaching teachers across.
But they need certificate from us, so how that
how
certificate?
No,
so that way you can also be part of the student who is observing how they are using ICT to deliver the lectures. Take the feedback from the students and also give your own points.
So the challenge is there, this is a suggestion, but the two challenges that they pointed out, assignment,
Yes.
But I want to also come back, let it not become a teacher's training. I thought we are also teachers, not always students of how to do teaching. We are also teachers. I think we need to really learn how to do better with that. So let's also have some discussion.
So one more thing there, we can use ICT is to reach out to the diverse kind of learners in a classroom, because we have multiple channels through which technology information can be disseminated.
Right.
So you know, visual intelligences,
yes,
auditory
yes.
skills.
There are different learning
yeah,
styles.
So I think we should
there is a host of different learning styles, and as has been documented, the lecture-based model suits only
one
type,
of
intuitive type of learners. It does not. I mean, I don't want to get into
the
theory
of
all that. I'm studying all that stuff, so I'm a little bit up on it.
Right.
But that is actually a huge possibility if we use the technology properly for addressing different types of learning styles of.
That's why the 6 to 9 minutes input is very important. That where at the strategic moment we have to use the video and then you know.
But before we can go as teachers, we can go there. We need to even
analyze, diagnose.
We need to understand that there are differences, which I, for example, most of us don't know. I didn't know till I started studying this. So that's.
And another thing, so one last thing I think. So we talk about 21st century skills. We talk about moving up from the knowledge and understanding aspect from Bloom's taxonomy. I think technology allows us to do so much more, whether it's synthesizing information or analyzing inputs and bringing it together and then publishing it in an e-format, which whether it's a blog or a website or a digital portfolio or videos, etc. For students, I mean, teachers can really sort of start practicing it themselves. I mean, develop 21st century skills in students using ICT, and that's how a teacher can actually, sort of result in learning effectiveness. Where we talk about engineers not ready to, be sort of entering the job market. So we can create those kind of learners, and that is possible through technology also.
Right. So sort of teach better skills, better listening through technology?
The process of learning in the sense, like we were talking in the morning, Dr. Anup spoke about different processing abilities, information processing abilities. So what we are saying is that we don't need to depend on pushing, for example, assessing students on memory and recall. We can raise up that
level,
and technology allows us to do that. For example, if we ask right now somebody to search information, synthesize what we are doing together, and then publish it, we can do it right now. We can create.
So actually, as of now, the current state of technology can do lower levels of Bloom and not the higher levels. That's what research challenge is doing. So essay, for example, they're now only building. So technology will let you do multiple choice, reasonable, simple. Recall answers are much easier to check with technology.
No, but then we have to create the learning engagement which does not force them to recall answers, but to do something higher. So that's where the teachers
simulations, games,
online. So, okay, I would put this as there is a possibility of, we should just put that down, certainly that there is different alternatives possible, alternative styles, mixtures for lecture hour. If I don't know, that's not exactly what you said, but given that we will all have lecture hours, technology allows us to use the lecture hour in multiple ways while still achieving and maybe achieving better learning through somebody's games, through simulation, through interactivity, whatever else. I think that certainly in the technology would allow for alternative styles of, loosely I'm calling lecturing, but it needn't be just lecturing. Clickers was mentioned in that, which is also part you can do. It makes, technology allows lecturing to get more active. Yes, sir.
Just a point, sir. I mean, just an observation. I think we all understand why ICT and why technology. I think most of the discussion around here is that we need technology. I think if we can just come back and address question,
okay,
and only ask for observation around the question, because I think we all are talking about that all ICT right. will change things.
Okay.
And we're taking it for granted that ICT will change things.
All right.
But the idea is how.
So,
I think how and why?
That's a big key.
I think it is the
granted ICT will change things. 3 years back, you know, I cannot imagine even having a discussion like this. ICT was a taboo. Mention ICT in higher education, both at the level of policy, there was very little acceptance. Definitely at the level of teaching community, there was very
But when we started this discussion, we had difficulty. That is why it has not been propagated sufficiently well. Policy is good, but implementation stage there are so many difficulties.
Your challenges are
How do we do it? Because we are going with an assumption that we have good content. Research is okay, assessment is okay, everything is okay. How do we do it?
This seventh question which is listed here, I think we should discuss this more, because just now Professor B. M. Jain said that average age in particularly old institutes is 45-50, and those people are going to retire in next 10-15 years, but they have taught for 20 years with blackboard type of teaching. How should we motivate them to adopt this technology? They are not ready to. They have become dead. They have become rotten.
Yes.
They don't want to go for this kind of thing.
Yes.
So how? I mean,
that's
the major challenge.
And if we have
in the institutes,
If we can just suggest one or two things for both the category, existing teachers and new teachers, so that at least we have some points which have come out of discussion.
Okay.
As suggestions.
You want to address the question. New teachers, existing teachers,
and
existing teachers.
Get them on ICT effectively.
Effectively, so they use it for better, for improved education in their classroom.
Yes. Yeah, same thing we propose, sir. That is the question number 5, 6, 7. Whatever we discussing, we are discussing the same idea. With the same idea. If it is new teacher, if it's only with the qualification M.Tech and something. No, it's not a teacher. That's why the question
that's
is
the
there.
Valid point.
So that's why the formal training for 2-3 months, we have already come out with that. Yeah. Right? For existing teacher, we can also motivate with the some of the thing, so that they can, means going for the some training sort of thing or something, so that they can start using some of the case studies. Role play, we can go for that.
Professor Kannan, I think it is the mindset. It doesn't
exactly
matter. I'm 60 years old, but I can go about ICT. It is mindset.
I want to add to him
the feedback which I was saying in the beginning of this, like the most of the teachers come in the age group of 25 to 35 years. So that's what the feedback which we have got.
Our country.
So what about the teachers who are actually 45 to 65.
They don't want to change.
Teaching, good teacher may not become a good online teacher. That is a fact.
Yeah, by the way,
Because if you have used technology,
as if we understand what is an online teacher. I don't actually. To me, that is the first question. I'm still a teacher. I get 3 hours a week to deliver certain course in the semester.
I still am actually not clear of the question, answer to the question, how do I use this range of tools available to do my job better, consuming less time, and reach out to the student better?
See,
I still actually don't have an answer. So if I have an answer, then I say, well, maybe she can say, hey, look, you are old, why don't you now, I'll tell you how to do it. Or I can tell somebody older than me.
Can I?
That I